Okay, hello. My name is Anna. I haven't seen you before and you haven't seen me before. So
we have.
This is like the first date today for me. Okay, so the inspiration for my presentation came to me when I was thinking about a variety of activities we can do during the lesson. And variety not just in terms of that stage is different one, but also in terms of senses, which are incorporated in our activities. Because why senses? Because senses help us to get information from the world. The second thing which came to my mind is that sometimes we come across some students, like we think, oh, so he's hyperactive, how can I deal with the student? Or he's so slow, like, oh my God, how can I put so much information into his head? And so on and so forth. And the third idea is that I think like we can be more creative and use like other stuff instead of just paper, colorful paper, strips of paper, and like other things, right? So the presentation I want to start with is called Multisensory Learning Boosting Your Student's Intelligence. I think it's pretty clear, and if I show you the image of this, it becomes even more clear. So it's about the senses, and it's about the senses which can be incorporated in our activities. To start with, the first question I would like to discuss is that, what is it? And the answer sounds very easily. So multisensory learning is learning that involves two or more of the senses within the same activity. Like adults, children take information about the world in a variety of ways. And these ways are very, very easy, and you all know them. That's through their ears, through their eyes, through touch, and through body movement. Okay, these following questions sound like, who benefits from it? And what should you know to incorporate it into your lesson? What should you know to incorporate multisensory approach into your lesson? And the answers to the second question sounds like, students. It's pretty clear. Why students? Because we teach them, and learning using multisensory approach helps you to maintain learning at full capacity, and it's very, very important. In such situation, not a one student left aside. Second is teachers. Like some people may say, how teachers can have fun, like, or can get profit from it. Very simple, because every activity brings you or creates certain experience for you. And the more varied experience, the more interesting it is, not only for kids, but also for teachers, right? Okay, and parents. Why do we talk about parents? Because I think parents are the people who need to know their kids very well, and they are, like, why it's important also is that it helps you to have good communication, much better communication and interaction between parents and kids. And of course, parents, they're people who help kids to do the homework. So multisensory learning is also beneficial for them. And answering the third question, what should you know to incorporate it into your lesson, is that learning style, learning type, and variety of activities. So talking there briefly about learning type, there is a bunch of ideas you can use during the lesson. How you can do that? You can simply look at your students and observe them for years to identify what kind of learners you have in your group. Or you can go to the internet and find some good questionnaires or surveys which will help you to do that. So I brought some surveys or sort of questionnaires today, and you can use them with your students too. Second, which is also important, is to know how many learning styles are there. So how many? Guys, what do you think? How many learning styles? Just give me a number.
Four.
Good number. Others?
Seven.
A bit more.
Nine.
A bit more.
11.
That's very, very close.
Wow.
So, a good guess. So, there are 12 ways of knowing. That's kind of like a big number, right? Should I know about all this? Actually, some of them, they are very, very specific, but they are very also important. So, the first four, I mean visual, tactile, auditory, and kinesthetic, they are pretty well known for you. But there are some other ones, like sequential, verbal, reflective, and so on and so forth. So, what I ask you to do is, together with your partner, group of two or like three, to make it more comfortable, can you discuss key points? I think maybe key points and activities which can go behind these learning styles. For example, a visual learner, you know, that it's type of learner who needs lots of colorful stuff, charts, tables, and so on, visuals, right? An activity which can be very beneficial for visual learners is highlighting different things, so like teaching grammar with markers of different colors, for example, right? So can you do the same, but talking about those words which I think you're not very familiar with, like sequential, verbal, reflective, direct experience, rhythmic, indirect experience, interactive, and simultaneous. Just 5 minutes, okay? Mm-hmm. 5 minutes. So, what's the question? Discuss. Yeah, I have no idea how to see that. Okay, thank you. So, please, together.
Which one is the first one?
Yeah.
Jelly children.
Okay, thank you. So I hope that your ideas were very nice and your partners helped you to understand it a bit more clearly. Every class, every learning program. To continue, let's look at the information and you have the chance to compare what you discussed and what is the actual one. Types of learners. So visual, auditory, tactile, and kinesthetic. Those ones you are all familiar with. So I'll go through very quickly. Like visual learners learn optimal for observation. They like to see visual stimuli, such as tables, graphs, and pictures. Some also have a strong capacity to visualize. So seeing something, especially in different colors, is very profitable for this student. Auditory. Okay, that's very clear. I won't read it. Tactile. What I'd like you to draw attention is that there are two types of tactile learners. The first one, some prefer to touch objects or manipulate objects. And the second, others find that taking notes or drawing helps to encode information. So students who like writing down things, like don't stop them, it's very important for them because they're tactile learners. Kinesthetic learners need to move their bodies. Activities and movement help them to engage in information. A very interesting thing which I came across in the internet is that there are even special schools for kinesthetic learners. Well, kinesthetic learners, they have special desks. So basically, they're not sitting at this desk, on the chair, right? But they're just standing next to it at the desk, and they even have a special swing for their feet. So it looks very funny, but it helps them to learn, right? So let's move on. So I think you are more interested in some new types. So sequential. Sequential learning like information to be presented in a series of steps or specific order. And you can see like some key words below, right? Order. So it's very important to ask the students to order information using different criteria, like from the best to the worst, or from the most interesting to the least interesting. Okay. Simultaneous. The simultaneous learner wants to see the big picture. It's important for information to be related and connected. So, and the word which will probably help you to understand it more, categorizing. Let's move on. Reflective logical. The reflective learner needs to think about and analyze material that they encounter. They like to think things through and create concepts or models. So when a person, like you, sometimes I guess you experience the situation when you ask the student, when you ask the question, and the student doesn't give you the answer. And the first reaction is like, he hasn't done the homework or something. Like, he's a bad student, or oh my god, like how long do I need to wait for his or her answer? So it can be a common thing for a reflective learner. Okay, so you should be aware of this. Next one is verbal. Verbal learners like to think aloud. They need to talk about their thoughts and academic materials to themselves and others. Do you students like talking? All the time.
Yes.
Yes? So, like, it's it's verbal type of donor. Then I talk in, and I guess it's very good when this person has a partner who also likes talking. So you will have a nice debate in your class. Okay. Or sometimes you can use such students as a teacher.
Yeah.
Right? So that's cool, right? You can have some rest and these kids are loading or teaching the information. Oh, of course, like to a certain extent. Okay, last one and final turn with that of learners is interactive. The interactive learning needs to work with others. They like the company of others while learning and processing information. So I guess you understood that one-to-one tuition would be the least profitable for these students. Okay, indirect experience. So I won't read like the both columns, but basically the difference between indirect experience and direct experience is that the first type likes demonstration. So if you have like a picture or if you have a video with some instructions and students can see how it works, how it's done by other people, so they find it very, very profitable. Direct experience, they learn things on their own. So I guess you all know about such an approach as when students try to find out the answers to some grammatical tenses like on their own. It works much more effective and much more memorable for them. And the last one, but not the least, rhythmic knowledge. The rhythmic learner is inclined to think in rhythm or patterns. They respond to music either appreciating or criticizing what they hear. They may walk to a beat, and some find that music blocks distractions. So, like, when sometimes we think that it can be distracting, so favorite melodies of your students can even be profitable for them. But of course, you need to measure these. Because there are different types of learners always in one classroom. Okay, and like I told the theory, right? But what's important for teachers? Practice, that's right, activities, right? So I have a bunch of activities and I ask you to make groups. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six, can you make 6 groups, please?
Welcome back. Hey, welcome back, Tyler. It was a TV show about a teacher. Welcome back.
Or actually, 4. I'm sorry. 4? Make it a bit bigger. Yeah, 4. For a minute once again. So what you do with these activities, there are loads of them. And you will see how varied they are in a minute. So you need to analyze these activities according to the instructions. Read it aloud to your group. Identify the type of the activity, whether it is reading, learning vocabulary, or writing activity, and so on. And identify a learning type. Who it is aimed at the most. What I mean, visual learner, auditory learner, kinesthetic learner, and so on. Try to focus on first the main 4. Yeah, so visual, kinesthetic, tactile, and help
me? Auditory.
Auditory, that's right. But also you can mention those ones which were before. Okay. So, here we are.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Do you have a handout for
that? Sure, I do have.
Oh, I mean, I'm just kidding right now.
Yeah, I have. Thanks. And you guys?
Big ball problem.
I
mean, we
can. I love this.
This one, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so 5 minutes.
Play-Doh.
Forming the letters with play helps build letter recognition as well as other formation. A class can be divided into two groups.
He was in the favorite for the kids to pick up. Basically, it's more than a
word. They help.
Can I stay together?
What type of lessons?
Students say each letter sound as they make down, so that's and also the I guess, the ones that are listening, sort of passive, and when they build the words, they can find out,
but they're not.
When kids see a picture, they write the word.
If writing another color or a vowel, if it's kinesthetic, then it's kinesthetic.
I wasn't going to say that.
But what they are still trying to convey to me,
I think it's visual. I think it's, I'd say, they're like being given instructions.
Yeah.
So it's not quite.
But they're doing themselves, which in the other.
Right. Yeah. And watching
the other. Oh, and watching the other.
Oh, it's okay.
So you play in teams.
Nice.
Also, if you can use the phone, it can be used. They do it.
We have simple fields, competition so it's very similar to yours.
Using flash drives to write cards onto the board.
Yes.
Okay guys, thank you very much. Hope that you had some time to go through most of them. So can you come back to your seats, please? Spelling. that the most important for teachers is our activities. Yeah. So what is the most important for kids?
Games.
Games. That's right. Thank you. So now we're gonna play the game. Hooray, game time.
Ooh.
She brought this game to the conference. No, I just want you to set in game mode, so it's not like the game we're gonna play.
What a bummer.
Sorry?
What a bummer.
Oh, I'm sorry. Like, I knew that there would be some people who like this game. So, and the game we're going to play is this one. But can you help me to identify what's the name of this game? Can you give me some?
Kitchen bugs. Kitchen bugs.
Nice. No?
Butterflies. Kitchen bugs.
It can be done inside and outside. It's very cool actually to do that.
Guessing game.
Yeah.
Because you can do it inside, it's
cockroaches,
right?
They're searching. Students are searching for something and they need to search for a long time.
Because the cockroaches can be very tiny.
Some of the cockroaches are.
For this game, we need.
Catch one.
Yes. So can you rearrange yourself once again? So there are nine groups. I guess that's like three people in every group.
It can be five. We are inseparable.
Okay, let's say we have nine groups. Now, choose a captain in your group.
Captain.
Okay, captain, see the captain. Oh, very respectful. Okay. Okay, great. We do have the captains. Now we need little helpers. Okay, and by little helpers, I mean the person with a good handwriting. We need to have the person gun, so please volunteer.
So we have our
you have? Right? Okay, great.
You can make it.
I hope the easy part is done. Okay, that's for people who will write. Keep it, you will understand why you need them. And of course, you take them.
Don't show it.
Right. They have like one.
Secret.
Yes, they will appear magically
as they need it,
yes.
Okay. The instructions are not easy ones, but we are adults. I hope you will cope with them. You can look at them all the time, so not to ask and like get lost during the game. Scavenger hunt instructions. I call the scavenger hunt for words. So words will be very important in this game. The first one, every group gets these papers with tasks, as it usually goes in scavenger hunt game. You need to look through the tasks together with your group. Then choose one to start with, ideally the first one, but you can do it in random order. Choose one to start with, read it aloud to your group, and answer it. It's very, very important, so you answer first, And find a picture with the word printed. Like where, what kind of pictures? The pictures are here, can you look? Yeah. So the pictures are located on that table, on this table, and that one. Okay? So, right, for example, I answered the question and the answer is apple. So I need to find the word apple on the paper printed, yeah? To make sure that this answer exists. Every paper has one answer. So if here apple is the answer, so don't look it here once again. Yes?
Do we have to like just write the answer, then stand up, run, get?
Oh, but no, run.
You just have to be patient. Listen to the instructions.
Yeah, like I told you. So, you answer, you find the answer on the picture together with your team.
Ah, so we run to automation.
You write it on the strip of paper. So you write orange or apple. Uh-huh. One strip of paper, one answer.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Together with your team. Get all answers. So in this way, you get all answers. You write all answers on a piece of paper together with your team. You go back to your seats.
Okay.
So you are moving all the time. Okay. You order the words. The words will make a quotation. Okay. Yes, treasure words. And treasure words is not the quotation. You will understand later what it is. That's why it's called scavenger hunt for words. And as a praise for you, okay, well, that's not the praise, sorry. Shout them out, I mean treasure words, and the praise for you at the coffee break first. So we'll be lining to get the coffee first. Of course, it's a joke, but it's kind of praisement for students to work effectively and well. Guys, sorry. Do you have the questions before we start? Yes?
No.
Do you have the questions before, like, right?
Where is the competition? So we have different teams, but we are competing.
You understand. You have the task. That's the competition. Sorry?
Do
you have the pictures, guys?
No.
They are for all people. Okay? Okay, guys, in a minute, stand up and start working.
You are about 2 minutes over your time.
Play. Thank you.
The procedure.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you.
What people think the most, would that be dreams instead?
Yes,
I don't know.
Yes,
maybe I should have that charming.
Yes, we do.
Yeah, too.
You know already.
Which one? In Ukraine,
okay.
What do we do with these words? Do we try to make a sentence?
Yes. Have you seen that? What
is the word?
Is it one quotation?
One quotation consists of one sentence. Let's just one sentence.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, guys, can you listen up, please? Uh-huh. Okay, so what's... No. I'm sorry? Right, all the words. Okay, all these quotations... Yeah, okay, all these quotations are taken from the books. I have the answers. I won't give you the answers, because we haven't reached the point, right? But you will have all these materials attached to my presentation, and if you practice with the students, you will see it's lots of fun, and it works really well for reading, not just to have fun, right, as it is supposed in scavenger hunt game. So, to finish my presentation, I would like to say very simple words. Thank you for your cooperation. Use those activities which I wrote today.